1 Kings 18:38, and the scriptures say this, immediately, what, say it with me, the fire of the Lord flashed down from heaven, and it burned up the young bull, the wood, the stones, and the dust. It even licked up the water in the trench. And here's what we all know about fire. Fire can be destructive, but fire can also be purifying. Like, we've seen the destructive wildfires in California and Colorado. But this fire is not a destructive fire. God could have destroyed the nation of Israel for what they were doing. Now, we've been talking these past few weeks about Baal worship. But, you know, about the idols and the temples. But what we haven't talked about is the practices and the things they were doing. What they were doing was so deplorable and disturbing. One of the things they had was forced prostitution, sex slavery. Women all over the nation had to come to the temple and they had to offer themselves sexually to a prophet to appease the god of Baal. The prophets would go out and the women would be lined up and they would, of course, pick out the most attractive of the women, which meant that some of the women were waiting 3 to 5 years living around the temple, away from their families, hoping that they would be chosen, that they could appease the gods. And that is disturbing. That is deplorable. That is so degrading and demeaning to women. But that wasn't all. Whenever their nation faced a severe crisis or a plague or something like that, they would offer their children as a sacrifice. This is what was happening there. But somehow, some way, God said, I'm not going to destroy you. I'm going to show you mercy. Now, I know when I say that, some of you have read down a few verses and you go, yeah, but what about the prophets of Baal? He didn't show mercy to them. But what you have to understand here is the prophets of Baal, they were the leaders. They were the ones responsible. Not only were they ones who were responsible, but listen, they were not going to relent. They were not going to stop, and they certainly weren't going to bow. When you look at the end of the story, the nation of Israel, all of them bowed in submission to God. But the prophets of Baal, they did not. And here's what God does. If you're not a follower of Jesus, this is what I want you to know. God stands up for the vulnerable. God stands up for those who can't stand up for themselves. God stands in the gap because he's a God of mercy and he's a God of justice. And so he made a way for the people as a God of mercy. He made a way for the people to be forgiven. That's what the altar in this story is about. That's what Elijah's sacrifice is about. This wasn't a destructive fire. It was a purifying fire. Why? Because if you read in the Old Testament, you see that the nation of Israel, God had said, you are a holy nation. I've set you apart, away from and apart from other nations. And by the way, that's what holiness means. If you've ever wondered, what does holiness mean? It doesn't mean being perfect. Holiness simply means to be set apart, to be set apart. In other words, God calls us to live different than the world. This world is full of abuse. This world is full of anger. We're seeing it played out right now all over social media. This is a divisive time in our nation. We see resentment. We see violence. We see murder. We see all kinds of atrocities and evil. And what God is saying is, I have set you apart, and I want you to show the world a better way to live. You've been set apart. You're to be a holy people.